Hello and welcome back to See the Pattern. In this week's episode, we will be looking at fast radio bursts, understanding what they are, what the mainstream theories behind them are, and then comparing it to how the electric universe views fast radio bursts. Now, they were first detected back in 2007 by Duncan Lorimer, and they are characterized by a very bright and very brief burst of radio photons, and they've been detected at frequencies ranging from 400 MHz to 8 GHz. One important characteristic is the arrival time of the frequency components is dispersed, which is consistent with the fact that they have propagated through cold plasma. Now, initially it was thought that they were galactic in origin, so within the Milky Way, but the mainstream consensus is now that they are extra galactic in origin, and in fact very, very remote, so from the furthest edges of our visible universe. Now, one of the challenges facing the theoretical model is finding a physical mechanism which could explain the vast amounts of energy radiated over such a short timescale. And again, here one of the problems is the fact that mainstream puts these objects at such a remote distance, and that would require them to be incredibly energetic in order for us to actually be able to receive them. Now, the sheer variety and complexity also adds to this problem. Some are polarized and some are not. Some have double or triple peaks, the rest just a single one. Many have complex microstructures, and only two so far have repeated. And the most famous one is FRB 121102, which has a modulated pulse shape with no apparent periodicity. Now, just to give you an idea of what these sounds like, so I've downloaded the radio file, which has been converted into sound. So here is FRB 121102 from one of its repetitions. And when you listen to it, what's interesting, so that's at normal speed, and let's now play it at slower speed. And the interesting thing, I think, is when you listen to this, there is a very clear drop down in frequency. So it goes from a higher note to a lower note as it goes through, like a ringing down mechanism. What's also interesting is the difference between the attack and the decay phase. So the attack is as it ramps up, and you can see that it ramps up relatively quickly, and the decay is longer. That the time it takes for it to go back down is longer than the attack phase. Now, the lack of observational data has led to a large number of theories, which can be broken down into two main groups. One which has an astrophysical mechanism, and one which is a mathematical physics-based mechanism. So let's run through some of these current mainstream theories and try and understand how, from their point of view, they could generate these FRBs, and let's look at some of the limitations of some of those models. First up is neutron star mergers. Now, it's believed that these sorts of mergers should happen quite often, and this theory would imply that a large number of these mergers should produce FRBs. So we would expect to see many more FRBs than we actually see. So that's one of the problems with this theory. Now, after the stars merge, the pulsar wind produced could explain a repeated FRB, but that would happen between 1 and 10 years after the event. And again, we would expect to see more repeated signals. Neutron star white dwarf mergers. Now, as the white dwarf approaches the neutron star, matter is pulled away from the white dwarf, and they speculate that the material pulled off is magnetized, and that as it falls onto the neutron star, these would release radiation in bursts. Now, repeated encounters could cause repeated FRBs. Binary star white dwarf merger. Now here, when they merge, they would produce a giant rotating magnetized white dwarf, which would generate FRBs via the twisted differential rotation of the magnetic fields and the subsequent magnetic reconnections when they break. Similar to, I suppose, the way that mainstream views the 11-year cycle on the sun, the fact that the center spins quicker and the magnetic field lines become stretched and then periodically they kind of reconnect. White dwarf black hole mergers. Now, in this scenario, an accretion disk is expected to form around the black hole, which could power a high-speed wind around the entire black hole accretion disk, forming a sort of corona. And the interaction between the magnetic field lines and the corona would create flux tubes, which episodically would eject relativistic magnetized plasma, and these blobs could occasionally collide, causing catastrophic magnetic reconnection, releasing a possible FRB-like signal. Now, as you can see, there are lots of ifs and buts in this type of scenario, let alone the fact that, have we ever seen a black hole? Neutron star black hole merger. Now here, the magnetic field lines from the neutron star thread around the black hole, and charged particles in the neutron star are propelled along the magnetic field lines, generating radiation similar, possibly, to an FRB. Pulsar and a black hole merger. Here you would have a rapidly spinning pulsar near a black hole, which could produce an enhanced giant-like pulse, similar to a non-repeating FRB. Two black holes, which are caught in its own in their gravity wells, spiraling in on themselves. Now, if one of those carries a charge, it would induce a magnetic dipole, and as the separation decreases, the magnetic flux change would be rapid, which would lead to particles bunching, and hence could lead to the emission of radiation similar to an FRB. The collapse of a supermassive neutron star into a black hole. Now, upon collapse, an event horizon would likely form before most of the mass and the radiation was able to escape. The magnetic field lines, in theory, are forbidden from piercing the event horizon, and so the magnetosphere would be left behind, and this potentially, as it expands outward, could generate something similar to an FRB. A pulsar in a nebula. So a young, rapidly rotating pulsar, which may generate giant pulses, resides within a nebula. Then the plasma wind generated by the pulsar would generate a sort of bubble inside of this nebula. Now, any subsequent outburst will rapidly decelerate and impact at the boundary, creating a gamma ray burst and possibly an FRB. Unfortunately, this cannot account for repeated FRBs. A magnetar hyperflare within a nebula. So similar to the previous one, so where you create a bubble, but in this scenario, you would expect to see optical flashes as well as the gamma ray bursts, and then the FRBs. So far, for any of the FRBs, no optical flashes have been detected. Now, another problem with any of the hypotheses that suggest flaring is that the upper limit that these flares could produce is about 10,000 times smaller than the energy that would be required to produce the FRBs that we have seen. Active galactic nuclei. So a hot accretion disk is formed as matter is captured and spirals into a moderately sized black hole. Now, some of this falling gas and dust is confined to the poles and ejected in two relativistic jets. Hot gas clouds of varying density surround the black hole, forming a toroid that extends a few parsecs from the black hole. As the active galactic nuclei jets interact with the cloud, it becomes narrowly collaminated, meaning that they are parallel beams and no longer spread out. Now, the beams encounter material at the center of the host galaxy, and this produces strong turbulence created by plasma instabilities. The electrons and the ions in this plasma separate, and these regions are called cavitons and have strong electrostatic fields. To me, this looks very similar to what we would describe as a double layer. But anyway, the electrons that pass through the caviton are coherently scattered and emit strongly beamed radiation pulses, which would be consistent with an FRB. Now, if they are if there is a local magnetic field, then 100% polarization, which is what we see in FRB 121102, so our repeating one, would be extremely difficult to account for in this model, unfortunately. So a neutron star which has an asteroid and a comet impact on it. Problem here is that the impactor has to be pretty large, and the comet or asteroid has to be made of either nickel or iron. Now, as it impacts, an expanding plasmoid fireball would be launched along the magnetic field lines, and magnetic reconnection at the collision site would accelerate electrons and anti-electron pairs to relativistic speeds, which could create a non-repeating FRB. Now, a body orbiting a pulsar, if the body was massive enough to survive a close encounter without evaporating or breaking up, then the highly magnetized pulsar wind would induce an electromagnetic field around the body, and this would create Alvin wings as the pulsar winds comb the field lines. Now, these Alvin wings would destabilize the plasma near the body surface to excite a coherent emission. Now, far from the pulsar companion, the emission would be convected with the wind relativistically along the Alvin wings to form synchrotron radiation, whose emissions would be consistent with an FRB. Now, interestingly enough, the emission is only observable when the companion is aligned between pulsar and Earth, and potentially this could repeat periodically. And the signal would consist of between 1 and 4 peaks a few milliseconds apart. Now, other models that we don't really have time to go into in detail include starquakes, so like an earthquake but a starquake, lightning in pulsars, a wandering pulsar beam, tiny electromagnetic explosions, which would be some form of remnant from the Big Bang, a white hole explosion, superconducting strings, and an alien light sail. They are all still in the running for theories to explain FRBs. So how does the electric universe look at these objects? First of all, let's understand possible mechanisms within an electric universe which could create these signals. So first of all, when charged particles accelerate within an electric field, they emit what is called synchrotron radiation. Previously, we talked about the fact that mainstream astronomers believe that the FRBs are outside of our Milky Way, and in fact, they believe they are some of the furthest away objects within our universe, you know, 3 to 4 billion light years away. But what if they were in fact occurring in our local neighborhood as part of the electric star process? Plasma discharge in the form of an exploding double layer could accelerate particles, creating the same type of radiation. Now, Hannes Alvin actually thought that the exploding double layers should be considered a new class of celestial objects. As we have previously discussed, Z-pinches in the plasma filaments could lead to galaxy formation and star formation, and we have seen that the variation in the incoming Birkeland current can change the behavior of the star dramatically, potentially causing fissioning. Now remember, we talked about this in the stellar evolution episode. Now, what if the incoming current did rise, but it wasn't strong enough to cause the fissioning, but instead caused a local change on the surface where the double layers expanded from the tufts very rapidly and exploded, creating a sudden release of energy similar to an FRB or a gamma ray burst? Now, we've already seen that this is what might have caused the brown dwarf X-ray flare in the electric stellar evolution episode. So is it that much further to suggest that FRBs might be produced by suns in an electric star model? Who knows? The fact is, we still have many theories to explore. A lot of the theories that have been covered today, unfortunately, cannot explain repeated signals. There are a few that can. Hopefully, as we look at more of these, we open our eyes up to the fact that potentially we are living in an electric universe. We may be able to explain these in a completely different way to what mainstream wants. I hope you found this an informative journey through some of mainstream's ideas on FRBs and a comparison to where we would view it in an electric universe model. As always, be brave, be curious, the truth is waiting for us. Until next time.